It'll be a while before we come back to it, but when we finally do, I'll finally get to talk about my favorite game in the series.
Yeah, about that.
Welcome back to the long-delayed Ace Attorney Retrospective. Yes, I know it's been a long time since the last episode, but hey, that's what happens when you have a weekly review show on top of a retrospective. Ask Linkara. However, now that my review show has ended, or at least the first one has, it's finally time for me to get back to this project and finish what I started. Now, it's been a while since the last upload, so here's a bit of a refresher. When we last left this retrospective, I had a bit of a marathon of four shorter episodes, in which I covered the Ace Attorney musicals, the fan-made crossovers Devil's Attorney and Turnabout Storm, and of course the live-action Ace Attorney movie. Coincidentally, that was also the last time that I've had a quick turnaround rate with these episodes. Yeah, I know it doesn't take as long to make these shorter episodes when the main focus of this series has always been on the games, but I do feel sorry for keeping you waiting so long. However, before we start, there are a few things I need to talk about. First of all, there are a few of you that might have gotten confused when I said that Dual Destinies would be next, since I'm going in chronological order. Technically, that means that Ace Attorney Investigations 2 should be next. That's true, but from the very beginning, this series has relied on me being able to play these games in English. I don't read Japanese, so I kind of have to rely on more experienced people who actually know how to translate. There was a setback in Ace Attorney Investigations 2 in that regard, because for some reason, Capcom refused to localize it because it came out near the end of the DS's lifespan, which is a thing that I have never understood. Yes, I know Nintendo's business model is to focus on the next console that's out, but that's kind of ruined by the fact that you can play DS games on the 3DS. Of course, since the last video came out, the 3DS was also discontinued, so I guess that's a moot point. A fan translation was eventually made, and as of now, that seems to be the only way you can play this game in English. As is the case with all fan translations, maybe Nintendo will prove us wrong and re-release the game in English on some other platform, but at this point I kinda doubt it. Although somehow in that time we also got a collection of both great Ace Attorney games in English before Ace Attorney Investigations 2 ever got a translation, so by this point I don't know which way is up anymore. So yeah, long story short, I'm going by the order in which the game was available to me in English. And in that regard, Dual Destinies came first, so that's the next game we're playing. But I think I might have misled you in another way, albeit unintentionally, regarding what I said at the end of the previous video. See, I may have said back then that Dual Destinies was my favorite game in the series, and that was true at the time. However, since then, more games have come out in English, and let's just say my opinion has changed since then. It happens. Regardless, Dual Destinies is no longer my favorite Ace Attorney game, and that's subject to change in the future. It's currently my second or third favorite, though. Also, here's an interesting fact that I learned in this downtime. Something that not only me, but a lot of other people that have talked about Ace Attorney have gotten wrong. Apparently, according to Shu Takumi's blog, the first game was not meant to be taken as a satire of the Japanese legal system. He just wrote it based on what he knew about detective stories, all of which he got from crime dramas. Now, do I believe that it never has been about that subject? No. Later games in that series would definitely lean heavier into that idea, Apollo Justice in particular. It's just something to keep in mind for the future episodes, including this one, because Dual Destinies deals with this topic too. Got it? Good. Now let me take you back to 2013. At the time, Ace Attorney was going through a bit of a dry spell in the West. Yes, Investigations 2 was already available in Japan, along with the crossover game Layton vs. Ace Attorney, but over here, we had nothing for a while. However, in 2013, the fan outcry was heard, and the fifth main Ace Attorney game was released in English. as an eShop exclusive. To add insult to injury, it would take Capcom another full year before we got our hands on Layton vs. Ace Attorney in English. Capcom, if you're not Mega Man or Resident Evil, you're lucky we allow you to exist. This translation job was rushed, and you can definitely tell. The text has a lot more spelling errors and things of that nature than an Ace Attorney game usually has. And Dual Destinies actually seems to have a pretty vocal hatedom too, which is weird to me. Granted, I know I'm the one guy in the Ace Attorney fandom who hated Trials and Tribulations, and that's probably the most popular game in the series. But Dual Destinies did answer a few questions we might have had after the end of Apollo Justice, and it had Phoenix return to being a lawyer. Granted, we didn't get all the answers, but that's what future games are for. The game does have problems, and I will say that after future games came out, it's no longer my favorite in the series, but none of them were deal-breakers for me, and I think that a lot of hate for Dual Destinies is overblown. I will say that the 3DS eShop is closing shortly after the start of 2022, so if you want to play it on there, you better get it fast. Otherwise, the only way you'll be able to play it is through the mobile ports, which are available on both Google Play and the App Store. It might get re-released later on like the Great Ace Attorney did, but considering that Investigations 2 is still in limbo and had to rely on fan translations, it might not. However, I've waited long enough for this video to come out, and so have you. So without further ado, this is Ace Attorney 5, Dual Destinies. We open on... wait, there are animated cutscenes in this game? That's right. I guess they really did take advantage of the 3DS's improved hardware, because a lot of this game is told through well-animated cutscenes. They should take these cutscenes and make some kind of Ace Attorney anime or something. Yeah, we'll get to it. Hold your horses. Anyway, the first case, Turnabout Countdown, begins with a bomb going off in a courtroom, which is forced to evacuate during a trial. Apollo Justice, the defense lawyer in said case, was injured in the explosion, meaning that it falls to Phoenix's other pupil to preside. Yes, ladies, gentlemen, and non-binaries, allow me to introduce you to the reason a lot of people hated this game, Athena Sykes. She's another fresh new lawyer taken in by the Right Anything agency, and as we'll soon see, another lawyer with superpowers. However...
she's been with us for half a year, though I can hardly believe it. Anyway... her power will be our greatest weapon.
Are you all right, miss?
That doesn't stop her from being a bit clumsy. Athena is there to defend her best friend Fluttershy. Okay, her name is Juniper Woods, but she's close to nature, she's always bashful. Yeah, she's Fluttershy. And she's facing off against Payne. But not Winston Payne. Yeah, this is Winston's much shadier brother, Gaspin Payne, also known as the Rookie Humiliator. The more things change, the more they stay the same. Things aren't helped by Athena's little sidekick. Meet Widget, Athena's personal computer, which she wears on a necklace. It becomes valuable later on, but it has the side effect of sometimes blurting out what she's thinking. We'll see why, but for the time being, let's talk about the case. During the courtroom bombing the previous day, every person managed to get out of the exploding courtroom safely, except for one. The body of Detective Candace Arm was found in the rubble. Wait a minute. Candace Arm. Can disarm. I just got that. Anyway, Detective Arm was actually about to testify in a case regarding another bombing before a bomb that was being presented as evidence went off in the courtroom. Oh, and the bomb was hidden inside of a stuffed animal. Oh, and it appears that Junie is quite sweet on Apollo because she went to court to watch his defense on the day the bombing took place and gave him some lotus root to help with his apparently injured eye. So why the hell would this girl blow up a courtroom? Well, according to Mr. Payne, it was because she had a grudge against the court system for being brought up on false charges earlier. And yes, we will get to that case later. This is another game in the series that likes to jump around with its timeline. What's more, there's the matter of the stuffed animal that concealed the bomb. This stuffed animal is the Phony Fanti, the mascot of a campaign to eliminate false charges and false evidence. According to him, phony evidence is just trumped up. Yeah, Athena's response pretty much says it all. However, there's more to it than that. The severed elephant's tail was found in the rubble with Junie's fingerprints on it. Athena tries to say something to defend her friend, but she freezes up. And we see brief flashes of a much younger Athena in court. Welcome to the reason that this game was the first one in the Ace Attorney series to be rated M. But never fear, for Athena is not alone.
Objection!
Why, it's you!
Like a mouse!
Phoenix immediately seizes the situation, gives Athena a pep talk, and decides that Junie's pretty traumatized after the bombing the previous day, so she's allowed to go rest in the lobby instead of testifying. Under guard, of course. But Payne, after vowing to cleanse his brother's reputation of the disgrace he made at Phoenix's hands, much to Nick's confusion, calls forth his own decisive witness so he can learn how Junie detonated the bomb. This is Ted Tonate, a bomb disposal specialist, who apparently doesn't like to speak or show his face. Oh, and he was the first to discover Detective Arm's body. But the judge asks him to remove his face guard and, wait a minute, it can't be.
And I go, yeah, baby, because I'm the evil midnight bomber what bombs at midnight!
Anyway, Ted says that he disarmed the bomb when it was brought to court, and that it can be operated by remote or with a timer. However, he says that he was able to warn everyone because he saw the bomb's timer ticking down, even providing an exact replica of the bomb to demonstrate. But before we begin the cross-examination... Wait. Is that what I think it is? Tutorials are optional! Praise Detective Bab, they finally got it! I'm sorry, but you have no idea how huge that is for this series if you haven't been following this retrospective so far. Anyway, Phoenix quickly points out that though Ted claims he saw the bomb's timer, he couldn't have because it was hidden inside the elephant. Naturally, because Ted is quick on his feet, he claims that he heard the sound of the timer instead and only made a mistake. Not only that, but he apparently saw Junie rearming the bomb before the case started and stealing the remote switch to activate it when she was in court. And it's going to be hard to prove that he's lying because the only time the bomb was outside of its transport case was before the trial started, and Ted has the only key to said case. And because they have Junie's fingerprints on the tail, that pretty much proves that she handled the bomb. Ted leaves with a smirk on his face as they bring Junie back in to testify, and she's even worse off than before. Not helped when Gaspin starts trying to force a confession out of her. It's here where we learn more about what Athena can do. She was born with a heightened sense of hearing, which allows her to detect it when a witness's heart starts beating erratically. And because she's trained in analytical psychology with Widget's help, she can tell how any witness is feeling. Now, it's not like mind reading. While she can read specific emotions through this, the emotion's intent has to be determined through further questioning. Widget allows her to determine where there are inconsistencies between a witness's testimony and how their heartbeat shows how they were feeling during certain parts of it. For example, in this case, when Junie mentions how the rubble fell on top of her, there's a strange feeling of happiness involved. When there's an unexpected emotion, you can press the witness for more information on it by touching the pinpoint button and hitting the right Simon button with the emotion on it. In this case, when Phoenix asks her why she felt happy, it's because just as she was about to get crushed by the rubble, Apollo came in and saved her. While that would explain most of his injuries, thanks to Junie's obvious crush on Apollo, they're able to get her to calm down. But with that new testimony comes a new feeling of sadness, which turns out to be because Junie lost her stuffed animal, Bum Rap Riney, from the same toy line that Phony Fanti came from. And according to a poster Junie shows them, Riney has the same kind of tail Phony Fanti does. Which means that it's very likely that the tail they found connecting her to the case was in fact Bumwrap Riney's tail. So with further investigation to be done, proceedings are closed for the day. Except for one thing. Where's Apollo? Well, according to Junie, he had an idea where Riney landed and went to look for him in courtroom number 4. But when they go to find him...
Where are you, Apollo? Trial's over for today! Come on, I know you're... No!
Thankfully, Apollo's not dead, but he did take a nasty blow to the noggin with a rock.
It was a big rock.
Naturally, Junie feels responsible, and though Athena tries to hide it with a positive facade, she's actually quite concerned for both of them. Of course, because pain is still a pain, he's quick to accuse Junie of assaulting Apollo. Apparently, he says she did it when Apollo first went to check the courtroom with her. Because otherwise, I would point out that she was in the courtroom the whole time and quite enthusiastically call bullshit. According to Payne, Junie hit Apollo to silence him when he found some incriminating evidence on her. And once again, there's some more evidence that seems to name Junie as the killer. Guys, has this ever once been the actual name of the criminal in this franchise? Because at this point, I'm about ready to say,
you try it 8 more times, maybe it'll work.
During the cross-examination, we also learned that one of the other reasons they went into an exploded courtroom to search for a stuffed animal was that Bumwrap Riney happened to have Junie's cough medicine in it. It has a hidden compartment, which is where the bomb was hidden in Phony Fanti. But things start to get muddy when Junie says that Apollo started his search at the witness stand, when according to the diagram, the bomb transport case was blocking it. According to her, the case was actually further to the right, where the message is now. And Payne actually ends up helping her case when he introduces another more pulled back photo, revealing that there are tire tracks over Apollo's bandages. Obviously, this means that the case was moved over after Apollo was there. Further proven by the fact that Apollo didn't bleed that much, so he probably didn't write the message himself. So what does the message really mean? Well, according to Phoenix, Detective Arm wrote the message, and what she was trying to write was the number on the bomb transport case, aka Ted Tonate's police number. But whoever assaulted Apollo used his blood to change it to Woods. And since Mr. Tonate was the first to find the body, he would have been able to move the case to cover up the message. But when he saw Apollo poking around, he knocked him out and used Apollo's blood to change the message. So I guess he really is the evil midnight bomber what bombs at midnight. Phoenix suggests that the blood from the message be DNA analyzed, and indicts Ted for the murder of Candace Arm and the assault on Apollo, finally dragging him back to the stand. Of course, Ted remains cool under pressure and states that Arm was too far away from the bloody writing for it to be from her. However, according to the autopsy, Arm died from contact with a flat object, not a sharp one as the rubble she's next to would suggest. At that moment, the analysis comes back, revealing that Phoenix was right. The message was written mostly in Detective Arm's blood, with Apollo's blood used to fill in the rest. And then Ted does the whole, I'm going to confess, but not really, thing, where he says that he moved the body, but didn't arm the bomb. Which is really stupid when you think about it, because why would she have written his number otherwise? Ted claims that she wrote his entire ID number, but in the photo, there's no R. Except for a small smudge next to where the 4 is broken up. Meaning that Detective Arm wrote this message before the explosion, and therefore was killed before the explosion even happened. Only placed there afterwards to make it look like she was killed in the blast. And since she and Mr. Tonate were together before the first trial happened, it might be a good idea to learn what they were doing. However, Mr. Tonate insists that he was only transporting the bomb, and Payne adds that even if he did kill Detective Arm, there was no murder weapon. Or was there? A heavy, blunt object that could strike with sufficient force to kill someone that could easily have been destroyed? Like, say, a bomb? Of course, Ted starts laughing maniacally, as all innocent men do, saying that he has no proof that the bomb was used as the weapon since, well, it was blown to bits and therefore they won't find anything with the victim's blood on it. However, as we now know, Detective Arm was murdered before the trial happened, so Ted needed a place to hide the body. And what better place to do so than in a case only he had access to? However, Ted had an ace up his sleeve. When Phoenix says to open the transport case, Ted says that the bomb he's been playing with all this time isn't a model bomb, but a real bomb, which will go off in 5 minutes. He even claims that he took the bomb out of the stuffed animal and replaced it with the one he made. The one he's holding now is the bomb from Phony Fanti. In the face of this, Gaspin runs off like the chicken shit he is, never to return. However, even in the face of possibly being blown up, Phoenix calls his bluff. According to the photo, the timer was broken on the original bomb, possibly when it made contact with Detective Arm's head. And since this bomb has a working timer, Phoenix knows that it's a fake. Or, you know, it could be a real bomb, just a different one. Luckily for him, he turns out to be right. And inside the bomb transport case is a very incriminating bloodstain, no doubt belonging to Detective Arm, as a DNA analysis will prove. And thus, Ted's alibi has been dismantled. Apparently, Ted was selling the bombs that he disarmed on the black market, which Detective Arm found out about and confronted him on, only for Ted to end up killing her to silence her. And the rest of the case plays out pretty much exactly as we figured, leading to Ted's arrest and Junie being found not guilty. Wait, I just realized something. Gumshoe isn't in this game, so where did all the confetti come from? It was established in earlier games that Gumshoe made it. Well, whatever. Happy ending. Except for one thing. Whatever happened to that remote switch? Well, not that it's a problem now. The bomb's already been detonated. And I'm sure that'll never come up again. But things quickly turn dark when our heroes get Apollo back.
Sorry, but I'll be taking a leave of absence.
Wait! What do you mean by a leave?
Can you at least give me a reason why? I can only say that this is something I must settle on my own.
Why, Apollo? Why are you shutting us out?
Athena also adds that Apollo changed ever since he put on that jacket, and that she knew he was a much more open person before on their first case together, when the victim was killed by some sort of mythical creature. But you'll have to wait for a while to find out where he got the jacket. For now, we flash back to the first time that Athena met Apollo in Case 2, The Monstrous Turnabout.
Long ago, the nine-tailed fox defeated the evil Tenmataro and sealed the fallen demon away. To this day, it is said that he slumbers even still within the forbidden chamber.
Night, night, Alderman. Sweet dreams! At long last, the revival of Tenmataro is at hand.
So after that cutscene, which feels like Okami meets Case Closed, we cut to a few months before the courthouse bombing, where we take control of Apollo. And apparently Phoenix called him only to have him basically babysit Trucy for the day. Hey, it's a step up from cleaning the toilet. What he's actually here for is to accompany Trucy to the old Japanese-style village of Ninetales Vale, where there's a festival in town. Phoenix was apparently going to take Trucy, but he couldn't make it. Also, as you can probably tell, this village has a minor obsession with yokai, or Japanese monsters. They go to Kyuubi Manor, so Ninetales Manor is in Ninetales Vale. Surprised? There they meet Jinxie Tenma, the mayor's maid and the one who invited Trucy to the festival in the first place. And because the world exists to screw Apollo Justice over, she immediately thinks that he's a demon because he's dressed in red and has the hair horns. It is kind of dickish of Trucy to not just say he's human, but quite frankly, with how paranoid this girl is, I doubt it would have worked anyway. But presenting his attorney's badge to her helps. Kind of. She still thinks he's a demon, but for some reason she trusts a demon lawyer more. Insert your own evil lawyer joke here. There are many. But she apparently has a good reason to be paranoid. According to legend, the demon known as Tenmataro has been sealed away inside Kyuubi Manor's forbidden chamber, after being defeated by the guardian of the village, the Nine-Tailed Fox. Jinxie mentions that there's going to be a surprise event soon, only for Tenmataro himself to arrive. But fear not, good little boys and girls, for our hero is here. The Amazing Ninetales! Meh, it's no more ridiculous than some other wrestling outfits I've seen. Apparently, this is an annual exorcism ritual for Tenmataro. He's released every year and driven out of the village to purify it. But this is the first time the Amazing Ninetales has done it. He's a pro wrestler from Ninetales Vale. However, the festivities quickly turn to murder as Jinxie runs out of the mansion saying that Tenmataro killed Alderman Kyuubi. Sure enough, Apollo runs into the Fox Chamber upstairs, though not before receiving another Tenmataro warning charm from Jinxie, to reveal the impaled man from the opening cutscene, along with another man who was thankfully just unconscious. The other man is Damien Tenma, the mayor of the neighboring city of Tenmatown and Jinxie's father. According to Jinxie, Alderman Rex Kyuubi was a kind man whose family supposedly had ties to the legendary Nine-Tailed Fox. Well, if a wolf and a half-baked prophet can have a wolf baby, I'm guessing that might be possible. Also, he's apparently a former pro wrestler who knows the Amazing Ninetales. All this info is great and all, but throughout this entire case, I was left with one question that was never answered. What's an alderman?
What's a paladin?
Shut up. Apparently, it's an elected member of a municipal council, though I've never heard the term before this game. Anyway, Jinxie's family originally came from Tenmatown, but she works at Kyuubi Manor because her late mother was originally from there, and she still loves the sight of the Ninetales flowers. But now that her father has been accused of murdering the alderman, and it's pretty conclusive that he did it, she suspects that that means she'll soon be all alone. And of course, that means it's up to us to save Mayor Tenma. Jinxie thinks that Tenmataro killed Alderman Kyuubi because there was previously a big seal on the Forbidden Chamber, but now it's gone. Plus, as we saw with Apollo, the scene had black feathers scattered everywhere. Of course, if you watch the opening cutscene, it already spoils that Tenmataro didn't kill him, so yeah, the opening cutscenes are kind of a double-edged sword. Anyway, this part also shows off a new feature for this game. Notes. Basically, these are, well, notes that Apollo takes for the current case, which essentially gives you a quest list. Oh, and apparently Jinxie's dad is really intimidating to the point where some people call him a monster. And believe it or not, that's a plot point. And that intimidation factor is shown off when Apollo goes to talk with his new client. Yeah, as you can tell, Mayor Tenma has got the whole face like a thug trope going on, but it's played for laughs pretty well in this case. And say it with me, Mayor Tenma's fingerprints were on the murder weapon. Game, you're slipping. Give me something I haven't seen before. Apparently, whoever killed the alderman both drugged Tenma and conked him on the head just to make sure he wouldn't have an alibi, and planted his prints on the murder weapon while he was asleep. What makes things look even worse is that lately, Tenma has been pushing to merge Ninetales Vale with Tenma Town. So the police think he killed the alderman because he was dead set against the merger. Tenma only has time to give us one request, to be a friend to Jinxie in her time of need, before visiting hours are up. But just then, Apollo gets a call from his boss that a new addition to the agency just arrived at the airport. But when she heard about the new case, she was already on the way to Ninetales Vale. Huh, did she take running classes from Pearl by any chance? However, once Apollo arrives at Ninetales Vale to look for her, we get the one scene with Athena that I actually don't like. For some reason, this cop insists that she's a high school student playing hooky. Maybe in an anime, but to me she looks like a college student. And even despite showing him her attorney's badge, the cop is like, "You're coming with me," and... Well, congratulations on that assault charge, Athena, and on a police officer, no less. I'm not sure why this scene is here. If it's to establish Athena as a badass, it failed. The cop was being a jerk, as many cops are, but there was no need to throw him onto Apollo, and he was being a jerk for completely stupid reasons. And even weirder, Athena suffers absolutely no consequences for that. Now you could argue that, well, Phoenix and Apollo are always breaking and entering and they suffer no consequences, but you could maybe justify that as them investigating a crime scene. I don't think that Phoenix, Apollo, or Edgeworth have ever actually attacked anyone. If anything, they're the ones getting attacked. And yeah, the police officer is left out cold and we never see him again. So for all we know, he's still sitting in Ninetales Vale somewhere. So yeah, this is a bad scene and I'll concede that. But honestly, Athena does get a lot more development over the course of this game, and it's a lot better than that. So the two introduce themselves, and we learn that Athena is actually younger than Apollo at only 18. Apparently, she skipped a few years of law school while she was studying in Europe. Meanwhile, Clavier's over here like, "Bitch, please, come back when you can become a lawyer and a rock star." Apollo quickly fills her in on the case, and Athena in return provides him with a newspaper she got at the village, which has a picture of what looks to be Tenma Taro, captured at 3:40 p.m. flying over Ninetales Vale. Returning to Kyuubi Manor, they hear a TV in the front room, which appears to be showing plot convenience news, as a news report kicks in that shows the amazing Ninetales went missing after the event Apollo saw. Watching the news is the mansion's caretaker, Phineas Filch, no relation to Argus, who quickly endears himself to Apollo by trying to steal his bracelet. Luckily, Athena spots this, though it's not hard to considering he's wearing the bracelet right after, and the two chase him off, but he leaves behind two diagrams, one of the fox chamber and one of the foyer, as well as his shoes. Speaking of shoes, though, Gumshoe isn't in this game. Sad face. But when the two lawyers arrive at the crime scene, they find what looks to be Tenma Taro's footprints before getting interrupted by a different detective. This is Bobby Fulbright, a detective who fancies himself a hero of justice. So to investigate the crime scene, our heroes need to convince him that their justice is more important than his justice at protecting the crime scene. It really is too bad that Apollo doesn't just mention here that, you know, his name literally is Justice. Also, since this was the first Ace Attorney game for the 3DS, we gotta take advantage of those new 3D graphics. So examining rooms now has a few more steps than before because you can now change the camera angle to examine the 3D room. But to make things easier, the cursor you use now gets a check mark next to it once you've completed examining one of the spots. You might say this makes things too easy, but it does this every time you examine a spot you can examine, not just the ones that are necessary to obtain evidence. So, I think it's a good way to keep track of what you've already done. Besides the footprints, our heroes find a bloodstained cloth attached to the alderman's overturned chair and a window that opens right onto a steep cliff. What's more, the window only opens about 6 inches, so there's no way a person could get out. Caught in the window, however, is what looks like a piece of golden fur. And beside Mayor Tenma's chair, there's a statue of the nine-tailed fox battling Tenmataro, stained with blood. Also, as Detective Fulbright demonstrates, the fox chamber has an air duct leading to it from the hallway. Before you ask, however, Athena already thinks of the old air vent escape trick, but Fulbright points out that while the duct in the hall is low enough to climb into, the one inside the fox chamber is 9 feet up, so there's no way you could get both in and out. However, after a bit of persuasion, thanks to Athena's insane troll logic of justice, they finally convince the detective to tell them what he knows. According to him, the fox chamber was locked when Jinxie stumbled upon the murder and she had the only key, except for Alderman Kyuubi, who had a master key for pretty much every door in the mansion, but that disappeared shortly after he was murdered. And the only people inside the mansion, besides Jinxie and the two men, were Mr. Filch and the mayor's aide, whom we haven't met yet, aside from the opening cutscene. However, Detective Fulbright has another more disturbing piece of news. The prosecutor serving on this case is actually a convicted murderer himself. Supposedly, he was assigned personally by the chief prosecutor, and Athena seems to be familiar with him, already knowing his name, Simon Blackquill. You know, I should be surprised that a felon is actually serving in the courtroom staff, but honestly, if this is supposed to be a new dark age of the law, and it's really not that far away from the prosecutors that actually attacked you when you were on the stand, I'll buy it. Also, he's called the Twisted Samurai, apparently because his conviction was what spurred on the dark age of the law. So yeah, there are definitely some things about him worth looking into. Oh yeah, and it turns out that the shoes Filch left behind weren't actually his, but Fulbright's. Apparently he stole them right off his feet. How do you not notice that? But speaking of Filch, the two run into him in the lobby and he has some shocking news. On the riverbank nearby, he found the amazing Ninetales mask, which is a big deal since masked wrestlers don't just take off those for no reason.
El Toro Fuerte never removes his mask.
Exactly. So Filch thinks he's been killed, but more importantly for the investigation, inside the mask, Apollo finds a single strand of white hair. Going back to the manor, Filch recounts that the Amazing Ninetales isn't just a wrestler, he's something of a local superhero. When the Amazing Ninetales started wrestling, it basically rekindled a yokai craze, which is just what the dying town needed. Now it's a hot tourism spot, as Filch demonstrates by giving Apollo something instead of taking it for once, providing him with a photo of the Amazing Ninetales. But of course, with all the yokai around, it's no surprise that the village is pretty superstitious. The Amazing Ninetales hasn't been seen since his last public appearance, and people are starting to think that he was actually killed by Tenmataro. And they also believe that Mayor Tenma planned to release Tenmataro if the merger went through, which the Amazing Ninetales supposedly vowed to stop. In less insane matters, when Apollo asks Filch where he was at the time of the murder, Filch tells them that he was in his caretaker's lounge, which has a clear view of the front entrance, with security cameras there as well. In addition, he was also with the mayor's aide, Florent Labelle, who can corroborate his story, and he didn't see anybody else come in. Athena points out the golden fur they found at the crime scene, which matches a spot where part of the mask's fur is missing. So this mask was, for sure, at the crime scene. And since the mayor had white hair, Apollo suspects that the mayor and the fox might be one and the same. So if you're keeping score, Mayor Ninetales, who lives in Ninetales Vale, in Ninetales Manor, might be the Amazing Ninetales. Game, I think that might be a bit on the nose even for you. Even Apollo doesn't know this for sure, and they decide to go and question Jinxie about it some more. This involves introducing her to Athena, and since Trucy went back to the office ahead of them, Jinxie suspects that Apollo the demon lawyer might have eaten her alive. Jinxie, I say this with the utmost certainty, do not give the Vore fans any ideas. But even weirder, Jinxie seems hesitant to talk about Tenmataro, despite not being able to shut up about him before. Well, as it turns out, it's because Jinxie saw Tenmataro running toward her and out through the foyer after she stumbled on the scene of the crime. Now, of course, this conflicts with Mr. Filch's story, but we haven't heard anything from Mr. Labelle yet, so we're gonna need a statement from both of them. especially because Jinxie mentions that Tenmataro was apparently carrying some kind of staff, a staff which Tenmataro has never been depicted with. In fact, those who needlessly depict Tenmataro are cursed, so there are as few depictions of him as possible. So does that mean Tenmataro is Muhammad? And given how the alderman was murdered and the fact that LaBelle told Jinxie not to tell Apollo about seeing Tenmataro, that makes him pretty
suspicious.
It helps that one of the superstitions surrounding Tenmataro is that if you look upon him too long, he'll claim your soul. Either way, Jinxie said she saw LaBelle back at the manor, but he's not there when they arrive. However, they do spot a TV guide in the caretaker's window, featuring a circled listing for what appears to be a wrestling match based around Twilight. Not gonna lie, I'd probably pay to watch Edward and Jacob beat the shit out of each other. Filch arrives and says that he saw the program that was circled, but Apollo, of course, has bigger fish to fry. He asks him if he saw Tenmataro, and Filch gets incredibly flustered, but before we can get a real answer out of him, LaBelle arrives and what the fuck is that? It's like if the Joker were a member of a drag show and got obsessed with shoulder pads. Anyway, after spraying Apollo with his personal brand of cologne, careful, it might have acid in it, Drag Queen Joker says that he doesn't believe in Tenmataro and denies seeing him in the manor. But he's also clearly silencing Filch, which leads to Apollo saying one of the dumbest things he's ever said. What does he mean by practicing statements? Apollo, what do you think he means? Seriously, how long have you been a lawyer at this point? Anyway, Athena does reveal her super-hearing ability to Apollo, informing him that she could detect in LaBelle's voice that he was obsessed with Tenmataro. Speaking of which, it's time to see the mayor about that rumor. Now, I gotta give this guy props, because when Apollo brings up the rumor to him, his first thought is that if people think that badly of him, Jinxie might get teased at her school for it, and he is willing to break out of prison to go and discipline her theoretical bullies. Father of the year, ladies and gentlemen. Fortunately, Apollo convinces him to hold it back, but more importantly, when Apollo asks him why he wanted to go through with the merger, his answer rings false and his bracelet starts reacting. Yep, it's time to bring back Apollo's perceive ability. It works exactly the same as it did in Apollo Justice, where you point out where a person's tick is when they lie so you can catch them in it. In this case, the mayor's eye twitches when he tells them that the town is attractive in terms of tourism. As Apollo found out from Filch, the town's booming tourism industry is only a recent phenomenon thanks to the amazing Ninetales bringing it back. But the truth is far worse. Apparently, the mayor never wanted to go through with the merger at all, but before the meeting took place, he received a letter telling him to go through with it or Jinxie would die. Apollo thinks that the blackmailer and the murderer are one and the same, and the murderer killed Alderman Kyuubi to kill off the biggest opposition to the merger, the Amazing Ninetales. Athena thinks it's plausible because the mayor was a former pro wrestler, and the mask being found lends further credence to the idea. The only problem is they have a motive, but no real suspect. Well, there are suspicious people, but remember, in the Ace Attorney universe, if you don't have evidence, it doesn't matter. Also, if you're thinking he has the blackmail letter, you're out of luck. He was keeping the letter with him in his briefcase, but in the time he's been imprisoned, it's somehow vanished. So it's time for the trial, and the only suspects are the mayor, who didn't do it, and a yokai. Just another day at the Write Anything Agency. Speaking of which, the next day at the trial, Apollo and Athena are getting ready to be defense attorneys for the first time in a long time. Apollo shows her how to do his Courts of Steel workout, mentioning that he and a friend from junior high used to do it all the time to help them feel more confident. Yeah, we'll get back to that. More importantly, Phoenix arrives to check on the two of them, and for the first time in a while, he's all dressed up, because he's thinking of getting his attorney's badge again. Because apparently that's something you can just do, even if you supposedly forged evidence. Yes, I know that that wasn't Phoenix's fault, and they do sort of explain it later. I'm just saying. He's also there to warn them a bit more about their opponent. Prosecutor Blackwell is known for using the power of suggestion to get people to do what he wants them to do, since, like Athena, he has experience in psychology. Anyway, it's time to go into court, and though it takes them a while, about the length of a cutscene, which is yet another reason this game was rated M, they bring out the Twisted Samurai, Simon Blackwell. And man, talk about your thousand-yard stares. though Gant still has him beat. Anyway, Blackwell proceeds to demonstrate his psychological manipulation skills by basically tricking the judge into doing his opening statement for him. Then again, it is Udgy we're talking about, so I guess it's not that impressive. Luckily, though, we have Detective Fulbright as our first witness, who's also here to keep an eye on Blackwell. Yeah, he's not exactly intimidated, but it turns out it works pretty well because, through sheer obliviousness, Bobby is basically immune to Blackwell's psychology.
Boy ain't right.
According to the detective, the autopsy revealed that the alderman had been drugged with a sleeping agent before he was stabbed, but fought it off enough to pick up a nearby statue of our two yokai fighting and club the attacker with it. Blackwell starts using more suggestion on the judge to make him mistrust Mayor Tenma and lean toward a guilty verdict, but Athena manages to put a stop to it just in time. However, he turns it on Apollo soon after. When Apollo brings up that the statue should have had the mayor's fingerprints on it, he manipulates Apollo into closing the contradiction by bringing up the bloody cloth, making Apollo realize that it was used to wrap up the statue. Still think it's broken to have a psychologist on your side? Well, not when you're going up against one. However, Athena brings up that if there were no prints on the statue, then anyone could have left them. Possibly even a third person who did the real killing. Especially since the room is still full of black feathers and tracks that were allegedly from Tenma Taro, and someone had to have left those. According to the prosecution, however, these were another fabrication by the mayor to prey upon the fears of the villagers to draw suspicion away from himself. Apollo brings up that there was the person who dressed as Tenma Taro in the exhibition match, but according to Blackwell, that was the mayor as well. To make matters worse, he's also figured out that the alderman was the Amazing Ninetales, thanks to the same evidence they found, and suggests that the killing was made once the mayor discovered his secret identity. However, Blackwell posits that the alderman had another reason for having this double identity, revealing that a blackmail letter was found in the alderman's pocket. And wouldn't you know it, it's just vague enough in the wording so that it could apply to either the mayor's daughter or the alderman's wife.
Ooh, how convenient!
However, a way out is found once Fulbright states that the mayor planted the yokai clues before killing the alderman, since the tracks and feathers are on top of the alderman's blood, meaning they only could have been left there after the murder happened. And if the mayor was unconscious after the alderman's counterattack, as they theorize, he wouldn't have been able to plant the evidence then. And of course, we still have Jinxie's testimony that she saw what looked like Tenma Taro fleeing the scene. Of course, Blackwell claims that she imagined the whole thing. After all, if there had been someone fleeing the scene heading toward the foyer, Filch or LaBelle would have seen him. So with nothing much else they can do, our heroes call Filch to the stand. Naturally, after trying to pawn off Fulbright's shoes on the judge, Filch denies ever having seen Tenma Taro that day. And honestly, we don't need Apollo's bracelet reacting to know that that's a load of crap. But there's an added wrinkle. When Apollo tries to examine his bracelet, he gets attacked. By a fucking hawk! Yeah, if you thought bringing a whip to court was violating some laws, meet Blackwell's faithful companion, Taka. Apparently, he loathes trickery and fraud, which Blackwell suspects Apollo's bracelet is. And because the court system in these games are purposely borked, he's allowed to keep him in the trial, making a lovely roost out of the judge's head. Maybe he thinks it's an egg. And as we already know, Filch was watching wrestling at the time of the murder. He claims he was watching the lobby too, but due to the way the TV was facing, he couldn't possibly have been. However, Blackwell tries to claim he could have heard someone coming down the stairs. Apparently, the stairs are very creaky when someone steps on them, and he didn't hear anything during the time of the murder. Especially because Tenma Taro apparently has a staff that makes a jingling sound when he walks. But if you recall, only Jinxie has seen him with that. All other depictions have no staff, even in the wrestling matches. And the only way that Filch could have known that this Tenma Taro had a staff is if he actually saw them. But of course, Filch can't tell us even if he did see him because of the curse Jinxie mentioned. Filch elaborates a bit on the traditions as well, giving us a notebook that contains another we haven't heard about. That ignoring the traditions will cost you your soul, but you can actually save it if you leave the village. However, as Apollo figures out, that would give anyone who dressed up as Tenma Taro the perfect alibi, since no one in the village could talk about him even if they saw him. Of course, this pisses off Blackwell because Filch's lies have made him lose credibility, so he sticks Taka on him, sending the Tanuki man running out of the courtroom with the bailiff in hot pursuit. And subsequently, he breaks out of his cuffs. Well, shit. And then he attacks Apollo with an invisible sword. I'm fairly certain this is meant to be metaphorical, as there's no real blade there. But not only can he cut things with it, but would you be surprised if it was a real sword? The Ace Attorney universe has done weirder things. Blackwell posits that if a third person dressed as Tenmataro committed the murder, then Jinxie should have seen him inside the Fox Chamber. So now it's up to us to question Jinxie and find out why she didn't mention it, despite it resulting in her father being accused of murder. After our heroes have a short recess, and I do mean short, thanks to Blackwell it's only 3 minutes instead of 10, we return with Jinxie taking the stand. Naturally, she thinks the judge is a demon too, specifically Norarihyon, leader of the 100 demons, though personally I would have gone with King Yama. I find it a little funny that she doesn't think Blackwell, the most evil-looking motherfucker in the room, is a demon too. Anyway, when Jinxie testifies, she claims at first that she saw not just one yokai in the room, but that it was teeming with them. But of course, this isn't the truth. Her memory is simply clotted with fear. Time to play Simon Says, Call a Therapist. This time, though, the visuals are a bit more intense. Apparently, Widget can create pictures based on what it hears in the speaker's voice. In this case, Jinxie is hallucinating that everyday objects in the Fox Chamber were yokai, and to find out what she really saw, you have to correlate those yokai with the actual objects in the room. Unfortunately, it works a little too well, because once those yokai are cleared away, Jinxie doesn't remember someone dressed as Tenmataro being there. Even worse, she recalls that she felt a sudden burst of courage when she saw a case with a Ninetales flower on it. So she kept it. Also known as removing evidence. Oh, and that case turns out to contain the master key that went missing from the manor, meaning that the only key that could have been used to open the Fox Chamber's door was the one that Jinxie used to open it when she first saw the crime scene. Therefore, someone else being the killer would be utterly inconceivable.
You keep using the word. I don't think it means what you think it means.
Athena gets frustrated at their inability to do anything, and Blackwell almost tricks her into running away until Apollo stops her. But it seems to be a futile gesture, as without any evidence to clear his name, Mayor Tenma will be found guilty. The only thing left is to introduce the possibility that another party could have done it, and luckily Apollo is able to come up with a theory. What if the killer locked the door from the outside, then went into the air vent and dropped the master key inside the Fox Chamber before fleeing the scene? However, Blackwell counters with the fact that if the killer had fled the scene through the front door, he would have been spotted by the security camera. But Athena points out that there's a window right behind the security camera the killer could have climbed out of. But as Blackwell reveals, this is also the cliffside of the manor, and no killer could have gone out that way. Or could they? Remember that newspaper article that captured the photo of the flying Tenmataro? Admittedly, this theory is pretty far-fetched, but given what happened in our last game with the elaborate pulley system used to exchange the murder weapons, I think anything is possible. Blackwell apparently thinks so too, even when Apollo points out that Filch apparently saw Tenmataro, suggesting instead that the real solution is the simplest one. The murderer was disguised as Tenmataro, but it was Jinxie. There seems to be no way out, but unexpected help comes in the form of none other than Mayor Tenma. It looks as though he's about to confess to the crime to protect his daughter, but instead, suddenly the mayor undergoes a dramatic transformation. The warding charm on his head rips off, and suddenly the one we knew as Mayor Tenma is possessed by the spirit of the dread Tenmataro. Like I said, plot point. Surprisingly, people do fall for this. Kinda. Blackwell does take this as a confession, saying that Mayor Tenma killed the alderman, then tried to open the Forbidden Chamber, but when he removed the seal, he was possessed by the spirit of Tenmataro. Apollo knows that he probably doesn't really believe this is Tenmataro, but he wants to convict their client any way he can, since he appears to be the only one who could have possibly committed the murder, so he's willing to run with the charade. And Apollo can't really object, because if he does, the only other person who can get convicted is Jinxie. At least for now. However, since both Apollo and Blackwell have reasonable cases to how someone could have escaped from the locked room, this does give us another opportunity to search for evidence as the trial is postponed. And when Blackwell tries to object, suddenly he finds himself coursing with electricity. Yes, it seems that the shackles actually have a shock collar function called the Jolt of Justice that allows Fulbright to keep Blackwell in line should he get too out of control. And he wasn't too out of control when he was slashing Apollo with the invisible sword before? Regardless, the next day our heroes reconvene for a new investigation. After Trucy makes all the evidence we don't need disappear into her magic panties, that is a sentence I just said, our heroes reconvene at the Fox Chamber. Our first destination is the air duct, and it doesn't look too good. When Apollo tries to investigate with the aid of our ever-present ally, the stepladder, he finds nothing but a thick layer of dust. So thick, in fact, that it would be impossible to crawl through it without leaving a trail. So it seems that now we're back to square one. Except for a few things. Bobby tells us that at the base of the cliff, they found a staff. Supposedly the one that Jinxie saw Tenmataro carrying. No fingerprints on it, though, that'd be too easy. But Apollo thinks that the staff may have come from the mansion as well, though he doesn't know where from. Also, supposedly Mayor Tenma remembered something, but in his possessed state, he's not talking. Even despite Blackwell taking him in for questioning personally. With nothing much else to do, they regroup at the Right Anything agency, and this time Phoenix is there too. He can't do much for them at the moment besides reinforce the advice that Mia gave him when he was still a lawyer. To always believe in your client, no matter what. And if you get stuck, try returning to the basics. Oh, and we also learned that he met Athena when he was on a trip to Europe and one of the many times he was studying law there. When Apollo gets confused by this, since he knew Phoenix as a nearly homeless pianist, Phoenix says that he apparently got help from an old friend. Also, after Phoenix mentions that Athena became a lawyer at such a young age, Apollo wonders if she might have been working this hard to help someone she knows. Foreshadowing! This pep talk gives Apollo the courage to keep going, so he and Athena go back to the detention center to have a talk with Mayor Tenma, Taro. Despite the whole possession shtick going on, it's clear that Damian is still in there somewhere, showing the urge to protect his daughter. But as for what he didn't tell us before, apparently he swiped the key from the forbidden chamber from the killer and swallowed it, having, gotten it back a few minutes ago. Also, apparently the statue that Damian was clubbed with was actually supposed to be a secret gift from Alderman Kyuubi to him, though he didn't see the statue before he was clubbed with it since it was covered up with the cloth it was wrapped in. Since neither of them know how to open the Forbidden Chamber or about why Alderman Kyuubi wanted to give him said gift, they need to ask Jinxie, who might know. But they're put onto the right track when Apollo brings up the blackmail letter, as apparently very few people knew that Damian had the letter in his briefcase. Except for one other person. Take one guess who.
Oh wait, you don't have to, because he was in the goddamn opening cutscene!
At least the lawyers take the hint and finally decide to go after LaBelle. But there's still one thing we don't know.
Motive.
Even if LaBelle was the murderer, what would he gain from opening the Forbidden Chamber? Our heroes go to Ninetales Vale and find Jinxie, who seems to be in a dazed, almost sleepwalking state before Apollo wakes her up. Huh. Well, further implicating Jinxie is the fact that according to her, the tracks and feathers weren't there when she first opened the door. If that part is found out, it'll further fuel the prosecution's claim that she fabricated the evidence. But there is a little bit of good news. According to Jinxie, the Forbidden Chamber opens with a secret mechanism that only the Alderman knew about. And since Mayor Tenma swallowed the key, we know that no one could have entered the Forbidden Chamber after he was attacked. Also, apparently that statue was supposed to be a gesture of goodwill toward the village. When Apollo questions why, as it seems like the two yokai are fighting in it, Jinxie says that originally the two yokai were holding a cup, a symbol of their union, but it must have broken off when Mayor Tenma was attacked with it. But when Apollo asks Jinxie if she knows any more, she says no. But Apollo's bracelet starts reacting, but before he can follow up on it, Fulbright suddenly shows up and drags Jinxie away for questioning.
Dang it, Bobby.
Well, either way, they head off to Kyuubi Manor, but end up running into LaBelle, who's changed his look slightly. Also, he has cell phones on his shoulder pads. Well, at least this makes them somewhat useful. Apparently, these are his own design, because no one else would be stupid enough to come up with them. Anyway, he claims that he did see Tenmataro, but that he lied about it to protect Jinxie. Apparently, that sleepwalking thing is nothing new, as sometimes she does drift off into that dazed state without knowing what she's doing. She acts as though she's possessed, but during those blackout states, she doesn't remember anything she does. Apparently, she's even dressed up as Tenmataro before. Even Apollo starts to question if Jinxie really saw what she saw, but resolves to question the mayor about her episodes later. And then Apollo does something stupid. Yeah, remember how Phoenix had a talent for questioning the actual killers without people around, thus ending up getting vital evidence taken or destroyed? Apparently it's contagious because Apollo asked LaBelle about the blackmail letter, only to have him take it and destroy it.
Think, McFly! Think!
And yes, you are required to do this. But this leads to a revelation about LaBelle. Apparently, he has such a massive ego that he buys public advertising space on TV and magazines for his personally designed products and won't sell them. Yeah, apparently he just wants to tell people about them. His business acumen is second only to his fashion sense. Also, apparently his hair color also comes from a dye of his own design, Color Me LaBelle, which washes off with water. Hair dye that washes off with water. Well, I hope you never sweat, because otherwise it'd be completely useless. He's kind enough to give Athena a free sample, which will come in handy later, I'm sure. Returning to the Fox Chamber, our heroes find something beneath the table. The broken-off cup from the statue, which apparently rolled under there somehow. Also, they find two foxes standing back-to-back on the folding screen, and two fox statues are on either side of the door to the Forbidden Chamber. As Athena finds out, the foxes can rotate. On closer inspection, the screen has a key and a keyhole on the back, and if you fold the screen in half, the two overlap, indicating that to open the Forbidden Chamber, the foxes have to be facing it. Once they push the statues into the right place, a keyhole was revealed, and the two are finally able to open the Forbidden Chamber. Inside, they find Tenmataro in giant statue form. But there's also a rack full of staves similar to the one Tenmataro was holding when he ran out of the manor, indicating that whoever our killer was, he was in here at some point. As if there wasn't enough reason to believe that thanks to this conspicuous bottle of hand cream on the ground, with a logo similar to the hair dye Athena got, with no dust on it, indicating that it hasn't been here long. Gee, it sure would seem to indicate that LaBelle has something to do with this crime, but there's really no reason to suspect that besides him being in the opening cutscene. Yeah, I know I keep harping on that, but that was really dumb. Anyway, our heroes observe that the statue has a staff, even though Tenmataro has never been depicted with one. Also, there's apparently a hidden compartment in the base of the statue. It's mostly empty except for a small statue, but it's so dusty that Apollo can't even tell what it is. At the base of the statue, Apollo finds a scroll depicting a monk with something gold that slowly turns into Tenmataro. This will be important later. Black feathers are on the ground, and Apollo theorizes that this may have been where the Tenmataro costume was hidden. And up above, there appears to be another air vent. But much like the one in the Fox Chamber, it's not reachable from here. Returning to the lobby, they find Filch, who of course tries to steal Widget and Apollo's bracelet. After getting them back, Filch apologizes and says it's in his blood. Apparently his grandfather was the famous bandit Azuki Kozo, something of a Robin Hood figure who stole from the rich and gave to the poor, and would leave a figure of himself at the crime scene. The same figure Apollo found in the Forbidden Chamber. According to Filch, the Forbidden Chamber is said to hold a great treasure, but since Apollo didn't find anything there, they surmise that it was probably stolen already. However, there is something else he can tell us. When he claims he didn't tell the truth on the witness stand because he believes in the superstitions of the village, Apollo points out that if he really did, he would already be gone due to the rule that says you can save your soul if you leave the village. And surprise, surprise, the real reason he didn't talk was because LaBelle told him not to, though he said it was to protect Jinxie. Filch takes back the Book of Superstitions, though in this case it's not really something we need, so I won't complain too much. And with that, it's time to go speak to Mayor Tenma, who seems to be doing fine now that Jinxie apparently applied a new charm to his head, at least until they bring up Jinxie and the demon comes back out. Apollo knows that they won't get anything out of him while he believes his daughter is in danger, but suddenly Athena steps in. She says that Jinxie's possession might just be a form of sleepwalking brought on by repressed stress, since it only started when she began work at Ninetales Vale. Now that he's more inclined to trust us, the mayor wonders why LaBelle would want to open the Forbidden Chamber to begin with, thinking that, for whatever reason, he wants to release Tenmataro. There's no telling why or how they can get him to admit it was him, but regardless, it's time for another confrontation. They find LaBelle practicing Filch's fake testimony with him in the lobby, because that's something an innocent man would do. Stupid evidence-based law system. But we don't get anything out of him, though Apollo is smart enough to keep the hand cream a secret this time, so at least he's sort of learning from his mistakes. Back in the street, we run into Jinxie, and we finally get a chance to learn what she was lying about earlier. Her hand shakes when she tells Apollo that Mayor Tenma didn't say anything besides what we already knew, but what she has to tell us isn't good. Apparently, before he passed out, her father told her to forgive him because he killed the alderman. Crap. Well, she hasn't told Blackwell this yet, but knowing him, it's only a matter of time before it comes out. But with a bit more information, our heroes lead to the second day of the trial. Blackwell has a new set of shackles, stronger ones this time, but the assertions are still the same. That Jinxie was the killer and she did it while dressed as Tenma Taro. This time, Blackwell calls Filch to the stand, but we already know he's lying thanks to that scene with LaBelle, especially when he says the staff came from the Forbidden Chamber. Thanks to the mayor swallowing the key, we know that no one could have entered the chamber after the murder. Apollo asserts that the killer is LaBelle, presenting the hand cream, and requests that a fingerprint analysis be done on it just to be sure. Blackwell already has the prints of everyone in the mansion, so the analysis is done quickly, only to find that the prints belong not to LaBelle, but to Filch. Apparently he stole the hand cream from LaBelle, and the Tenma Taro that Jinxie saw was actually Filch. But as it turns out, Filch was doing what the alderman told him to do. He wanted Filch to be the Tenma Taro at the event outside the mansion, and he was the one in the suit there. However, after that event, he got an idea. Using the superstitions of the village to effectively make himself invisible, he could go anywhere he wanted, so he decided to take a crack at the Forbidden Chamber's treasure. And he didn't use the door to get in. Instead, he used the air duct that we saw in the Forbidden Chamber, which apparently lets out inside the foyer. But after finding no treasure, he made his way out and got rid of the costume by tossing it out the window. Meaning that the flying Tenma Taro in the newspaper was actually just the costume falling out of the mansion. But the question is, how did Filch get out of the chamber? There's no way to get up to the vent once you're inside. Well, apparently the door was opened for him from the other side. But by whom, he doesn't know, or claims not to know. Either way, he grabbed one of the staves from the rack and hightailed it once he had a way out. Why did he grab one of the staves? Was he hoping to use it as a weapon or something? But this proves to be a blessing in disguise, since because he knew that Filch was in the Forbidden Chamber, LaBelle's alibi no longer holds up. However, though it seems like our heroes have finally dragged out the killer, Apollo can't help feeling that something isn't right. And sure enough, when LaBelle takes the stand, he claims that he was lying to protect Mayor Tenma, and the person who opened the door for Filch was him. What's more, he also claims to have heard the confession that Jinxie mentioned, making the mayor look even more guilty. However, his testimony is soon shown to be full of holes. He claims that he saw the events and fled to the hallway by the phone, but if he had, he would have crossed paths with Jinxie. Then he claims that he entered the Fox Chamber after Jinxie fled and hid behind the screen. But when further pressed about the weapons, he reveals that he saw the yokai statue back when it still had the cup on it. Though it seems decisive to Apollo, Blackwell counters that not only could he have seen the cup before, but that Jinxie didn't see LaBelle at the scene of the murder. It seems as though a guilty verdict is inevitable, until Mayor Tenma steps in, still doing his whole possession shtick. It might be our hero's last chance, so Apollo asserts that he should be allowed to testify. And at first it seems like utter gibberish, claiming that he came out of the darkness to see Tenma Taro and the nine-tailed fox towering over him. But Athena can sense discord in his heart, so it's time for another therapy session. They realize that what Damian remembers makes sense if he was inside the Forbidden Chamber, with a giant Tenma Taro statue looming over him. But when he struggles to remember what was in the Nine-Tailed Fox's place, he remembers that it was the amazing Nine-Tails, or someone dressed like him, opening up the Forbidden Chamber's door. And apparently whoever it was had on a red cape, which made him upset, and it contradicts how the amazing Ninetales usually looks. But there was indeed something red there, and of course that redness turns out to be blood. Specifically, blood from the alderman's body behind him. However, Blackwell brings up that Jinxie saw her father and the alderman in the chamber, and no one else. So how could LaBelle have been there? Well, what if he was in disguise? But the only way he could have been in disguise as the mayor is if his face were completely covered up. By, say, a fox mask? Yes, as Apollo figures out, it seems that we had it completely backward all along. The true amazing Ninetales was not Alderman Kyuubi, but rather Mayor Tenma. And that's why Jinxie didn't remove his mask. She knew her father was actually the Amazing Ninetales, and thus she wouldn't think to question it or remove it if she saw someone else in the mask. And that's the person that she actually saw confess. LaBelle did so as the mayor, while still in the mask. Which, honestly, makes for a pretty hilarious image, even despite the circumstances. And people say they have trouble taking me seriously when I'm in costume. So here's what really happened. LaBelle brought the alderman and the mayor coffee laced with a potent sleeping drug. Once the alderman was out cold, LaBelle shish kebobbed him as we saw in the cutscene. Then he took the drugged mayor into the forbidden chamber, donned some of the mayor's spare clothes, and with the mask had that fake confession with Jinxie. He opened the door to the forbidden chamber once Jinxie had gone to drag the real mayor out, but ended up catching Filch by surprise, who happened to be in the chamber at the time. He ran outside in full Ten Mataro costume where Jinxie saw him and leaving behind the trail of feathers and tracks. With Jinxie scared out of her mind, LaBelle was left alone to drag the real mayor out and plant him at the scene of the crime. Then he threw the mask out the window where it was found in the river. Blackwell tries to counter that the Amazing Ninetales wouldn't have been pushing for the merger, but Apollo reminds the court that the mayor was being blackmailed into it, and thus created the Amazing Ninetales as a way of protesting against it. And it seems as though Tenma is about to admit it, when suddenly LaBelle bursts in, claiming that he isn't the Amazing Ninetales, and if he admits it, then LaBelle would reveal the horrible truth behind Tenmataro, which would supposedly bring ruin upon Ninetales Vale. So this guy is clearly openly blackmailing the guy in the middle of a court of law, and somehow that's not a crime. This really is the dark age of the law. Basically, the only way the defense still has a case is if the mayor is actually the Amazing Ninetales, something that he can't admit at the risk of having the secret behind Tenmataro revealed. However, nothing says that we can't find out that secret ourselves. Apparently, Tenmataro is some kind of great fortune, and the superstitions were created just so people would never learn its secret. However, as we know, that treasure was already gone, thanks to Grandpa Tanuki. And with the treasure stolen, there's nothing stopping the mayor from revealing the truth. That scroll in the Forbidden Chamber depicts the events. Tenmataro was in fact a giant gold ingot that was used by Mayor Tenma's ancestors to purchase land from Ninetales Vale, land that would soon become Tenma Town. However, that treasure drove the people of Ninetales Vale mad with greed, resulting in battle after battle until the treasure was sealed away for the good of the people, with superstitions being created around it to prevent history from repeating itself. And with that, the mayor is finally able to reveal his secret identity, despite LaBelle's protests. However, of course, we have to have evidence if we want a conviction. And hey, we're almost at the end of the case, so why not introduce a new mechanic? Well, it's not a huge one. In fact, it kind of feels like a natural extension of the gameplay we had previously. It's basically the final blow mechanic, where we zoom into the player lawyer's head and follow the trail of logic to its final conclusion. In this case, remember that white hair found inside the Ninetales mask? Well, if that hair belonged to LaBelle, it would inexorably link him to the crime. But of course, if that hair is white, how could it be LaBelle's? Well, it comes back to that hair dye that Athena got from him. The kind that washes off with water. And since the mask was found in the river, there's a good chance that it could be his. All they need is a DNA test to prove it. However, in his breakdown, LaBelle ends up basically proving it himself. You see, this whole time, whenever things weren't going his way, he'd spritz himself with his own cologne so they wouldn't see him sweat. And... without his makeup, LaBelle is revealed to be a withered old man, with his media empire crumbling under him as he collapses on the stand. Turns out the reason he needed Tenmataro was that he's actually swimming in debt, his facade of richness being just as fake as his makeup. And with that, Mayor Tenma is finally pronounced not guilty. We rejoin Phoenix in the lobby, where Athena is still left with a question. Why not kill the mayor, too? Well, apparently the way he'd set it up, if he had, the Amazing Ninetales would have died a hero. LaBelle had planned to expose Tim as true identity himself, and once his fans had left him, then he could quietly kill him and feel free to search the chamber at his leisure. However, despite Mayor Tenma being happily reunited with Jinxie, he believes that now he'll have to retire the Ninetales identity, since everyone knows who he is now, and he's not the most popular of people. But apparently, he'd underestimated his fans, as there's a huge crowd outside clamoring to see him. Apollo hands him his mask, and the case ends with the future looking bright for Ninetales Vale and Tenma Town. After all, they have their hero back. Our team decides to celebrate at Eldoon's Noodles. Actually, Apollo hated Eldoon's Noodles and Apollo Justice. Clearly, he would not be happy to be going there, ruined forever. But while things seem happy now, Apollo finds himself flashing back to Athena's first case where she was overseeing the defense, which took place at her alma mater, Themis Legal Academy. Except we won't be covering that next. For you see, Dual Destinies was the first Ace Attorney game to fall victim to a far greater evil than that of any murderer. Yes, the evil of downloadable content.
Ha 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 ha!